Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this last of the series of six lectures I've given on some broad topics in science and religion. And what I've been trying to do in these lectures is just open up some interesting questions. I'm always telling you what I think, but really I think that the important thing is what you think, and I'm trying to give you space to think these things through by giving you lots of ideas to help you in that process. This final lecture is called Why God Won't Go Away. And in it, I'm going to explore this question of whether religion is simply something that's here for a time and then will go, or whether there's something more permanent about it, and some of the reasons for thinking that might be the case, and of course some of the objections that might be raised. And in many ways, this is a lecture that just sums up some of the themes we've been exploring in these lectures. Whether you think Christianity is right or wrong, one of its core ideas is that in some way human beings are hardwired to think about or even long for God. In other words, there seems to be something intrinsic to us that makes us want to ask and answer what Karl Popper calls ultimate questions. And we find this idea expressed in lots of places. The one that occurs to me is this very famous quote. I know I haven't put it on the screen, I'll just read it to you, from Augustine of Hippo. This is going back to about the year 397, and it's a prayer he wrote, which many of you, I think, will recognize. You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. Let me read that again. You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. And this is Augustine summarizing his own view of things, which is there is something about human nature, which means we are meant to relate to something beyond us. And until and unless we do that, there's this feeling of unfulfillment or dissatisfaction that is deeply inbuilt into human nature. And of course, you will find that idea developed by a number of writers since then. You might think of Pascal. Pascal talked about a God-shaped abyss, a sort of depth. Sometimes in popular literature, you hear this referred to as a God-shaped gap. It's not a word that Pascal himself used. It's much more this idea of something immensely deep within us that needs to be filled, and has to be filled by something that's pretty big, to put it very, very crudely. Or you might think of C.S. Lewis's deep idea of a yearning for God, or a yearning for significance, which both originates from and leads back to God. And so one of the themes I'm looking at in this final lecture is whether there is something natural about belief in God. In other words, it's not something that has to be imposed on us. It's sort of way, it's something that seems to emerge naturally within us. Now, obviously, this is a very debatable idea. Many of you will say, well, of course, the Age of Reason, the Enlightenment, as we call it, saw this view challenged in a number of ways. One of the most important arguments developed during the Enlightenment was that religion was something that was imposed on people. In other words, you wouldn't naturally come to this position, but rather it's something that society or powerful individuals impose on you. I think in recent years, there are complicating factors here. And one of them is this idea, which I'll be describing in more detail later in this lecture, which is to do with what is called the cognitive science of religion, which is saying that there seems to be something natural about human thought processes that leads you not necessarily to the idea that there is a single God, but rather to the idea that there is something beyond what we experience and observe around us. Now, of course, let me emphasize, it doesn't make it right, it doesn't make it wrong. But the point is that rationalism held that religion arose through what are called the sleep of reason. In other words, through the suspension of normal human critical and rational faculties. Whereas there are growing indications that it's not that simple at all, that actually religion is really a natural phenomenon which arises through natural thought processes, not in spite of them. Now, obviously, there are lots of ideas to explore here. And we might just explore this one. Supposing, that religious beliefs arise naturally in human cognitive development. In other words, it's just very natural for us to think like this. Is that good news or bad news for atheism or theism? I think you can see, actually, this is open for argument. If it's natural, well, you could argue, since it's natural, we need to move beyond that. In other words, you want to be more sophisticated than that. On the other hand, if it's natural, It means it's not imposed on you. This is a very very straightforward, a very reasonable way of thinking. So there is a very big debate here that's going on. My own view, for those of you who are interested, is that I think this works more in theism's favour than in its disfavour, but it isn't actually as straightforward as you might think. And to give you an example, some would argue that the most natural religious position is not theism. There is one God, but rather some form of polytheism. In other words, there are lots of gods. And you might argue, although again you need to be careful about this, that religious development is about a movement from polytheism towards monotheism. But again, I need to emphasize that it's not really that straightforward. But today I want to talk about a relatively new arrival on the block, so to speak, the cognitive science of religion, which was a discipline introduced by Justin Barrett, born in 1971. So it's a relatively recent discipline. This, I think, really got underway in the early 2000s. So it is quite recent. And Justin Barrett and others basically said, let's apply cognitive science, that is to say, the basic understanding of how human thought processes work and see how that impacts on religion. And obviously there are issues here which some of you will say need to be sorted out first. For example, what actually is religion? How do you define that? And that actually isn't all that straightforward, because religion isn't actually really an empirical idea. It's something more cultural than that. But nevertheless, Justin Barrett's argument is that we don't need to agree on a definition of that word religion before we can do the cognitive science of religion. And Barrett's argument is that that patterns of thought and action which can be meaningfully described as religious are deeply embedded in human culture now, and as far as we can see, always have been. And really the point that Justin Barrett makes, through in effect looking at the way human thought processes work, is that religion seems to arise through normal processes of thought, not in opposition to them. In other words, it's a natural aspect of human being, again, whether this is right or wrong. Now, Justin Barrett says we don't really need a rigorous definition of religion, but nevertheless, I think that you can argue that religion is something that we have a sort of basic sense of what it's all about, a sort of belief in God or gods, a sense there is a transcendent realm beyond what we see and observe around us, and a sense that this impacts on the way in which we live and think today. But certainly, what Barrett is saying is that this is a very natural way of thinking. And he's joined in this by other writers. Pascal is a very good example. And their argument is that it is very, very natural to believe in God. But I now just pause here and try and unpack this in a little bit more detail. There are two points I'm going to make. The first of these is that we need to make a distinction between what I'm going to call religion, that's a sort of experienced thing, and theology, which is a more reflective thing. And both Barrett and Pascal Boyer, in a different ways, say that it's religion that's natural, not theology. In other words, theology is something that comes about by reflecting on religion, but actually religion is the primary thing. Having a sort of sense of what religion is all about motivates you to begin to ask the kind of questions that you and I would describe as being theological. And the second point both Barrett and Boyer make is this, and I think it's a very important one, that religious ideas tend to be very, very simple. God can be trusted, something like that. Theological ideas tend to be much more abstract and much more counterintuitive. And the example I will give later in this lecture is the idea of the Trinity, which certainly, to me, is a very deeply counterintuitive idea, and one that makes sense when you begin to look at it in detail. But when you first see it, you begin to think this just cannot make sense. There's something fundamentally wrong about this. It does need to be looked at in much more detail. Whereas for Barrett and Boyer, religious ideas, there is an ultimate ground which can be trusted, is actually a much simpler idea than that. And they use the language of minimal counterintuitiveness. It's not an easy phrase to remember. What they're saying is that in many ways, religious ideas go with the grain of being human. Actually, it's quite easy for us to absorb these ideas and make sense of them. So what they are saying is not so much that religious ideas are rational, in the sense of something that can be proved by reason or proved by empirical observation. It's much more these seem to fit in relatively easily to human ways of thinking. They don't cause us massive mental discomfort. Now, some of you will say, well, you know, if they are simply minimally counterintuitive, why would anybody actually believe in these things? And of course, one of the points that both Barrett and Boyer make is that this is not simply about cognitive understanding. It's something deeper than that. It's existential. It's something that actually impacts on those big questions, what Karl Popper calls ultimate questions, and gives a sense of meaning and direction and purpose. So actually there is quite a big payoff here. But nevertheless, this notion of minimal counterintuitiveness is just saying that there are issues there that need to be engaged. So where does this kind of thinking take us? What sort of ideas does this open up? And I think that in many ways, this raises, I think, a very interesting question. The question goes back to Sigmund Freud. Freud was pre-committed to atheism and kind of explained religion from that standpoint. In other words, the assumption was atheism is right, and therefore there has to be a simple reductive explanation for religion because there cannot be a God, and therefore there has to be some other way of explaining this. I guess one of the questions you might ask about both Barrett and Boyer is, do these people have pre-commitments that might move them in directions, such as, for example, this idea of minimal counterintuitiveness? I think the answer is that Barrett and Boyer are actually coming from different ends of the spectrum. And Barrett is a Christian who I think finds this sort of stuff fits in quite well, this way of thinking. Boyer takes the view there is nothing transcendent at all, but nevertheless feels that this is the way in which humans think. And it's very important to begin to understand what this is all about. So on the table is this idea that it's very natural for human beings to be religious. If that's right, where does that take us? So I'm going to open up just some of the questions that begin to emerge from it. And one of the questions we might begin by asking is this: how does this fit in to a bigger theological framework? And it's a very interesting idea because one of the questions that you look at in theology, as indeed you do in philosophy, is how a sort of mental framework, a way of thinking, actually impacts on the way in which you interpret experience. And I'll be coming back to this because all the best theologies and philosophies are those which are not simply abstract ideas, but actually are able to gain traction on the experiences we have in everyday life. In other words, they help us to engage experience, they help us to make sense of experience, and that actually is seen as being very important by people. One biblical theme that theologians pick up on is an idea you find in the Old Testament, for example, the book of Ecclesiastes, which talks about God having, listen to this, placed eternity in our hearts. God has placed eternity in our hearts. What's that all about? Well, I think one way of beginning to open that up might be to say there is some inbuilt, or if you like, created human predisposition to think about these big ultimate questions which involve transcendence or eternity or God, and that actually is just part and parcel of being human. And of course, that quote I gave you from Augustine earlier fits into this package very, very neatly. But there's another point to make here. I'm going to draw on Robert McCauley of Emory University in Georgia in the United States, who's done a lot of very interesting empirical work on not just the relationship between religion and theology and whether religion is something natural, but also how this relates to the natural sciences. And McCauley asks this question: what does it mean to say that a belief is natural? And his answer is quite straightforward. He says it is something which is, I quote, familiar, obvious, self-evident, intuitive, or held, or done without reflection. In other words, you don't have to force it into this mold. It just seems to fit in easily, naturally, and seamlessly. And Macaulay's argument is that on the basis of the experiments he has done, religion is actually quite natural for people. Now, again, I emphasize, natural doesn't mean right, but certainly it just means that it fits in quite easily with our ways of thinking. However, he then makes a point, which I think most of you will recognize immediately, that while it may be natural to think there is a God, or a God who may be trusted or something like that, when you start beginning to take rational trouble about this and do theology, so to speak, you end up getting very counterintuitive very quickly indeed. Now, I mentioned earlier the whole idea of the Trinity, and that's the idea in Christian theology that the simple idea of God isn't good enough, that you have to have this threefold notion of God as Father and Son and Spirit. And certainly for many people, that is actually just impossible to get your head around. It seems to say there are really three gods. Now, those of you who've studied theology will say, well, actually, it's not that simple. What is really being said here is that the human mind is simply not able to get itself around God in all of God's fullness. And so, in many ways, what the Doctrine of Trinity is trying to do is to say, look, this is just too big for us to take in fully, and so our instinct is to reduce it to something manageable that we can cope with. We've got to resist that and preserve the mystery rather than simply reduce it to categories we can cope with. And so in many ways, Doctrine of Trinity is trying to say, please don't reduce this to something manageable. Just recognize it is very, very big and very, very hard to take in. But Macaulay's point is that seems to be a general pattern. Religion is very, very easy, very, very natural. When you start doing theology, you seem to end up in a very different place. Now, although I'm a theologian and actually quite like theology, I would have to concede that Macaulay is making quite an important point here. There is, if you like, a distinct logic of faith which has to be learned, and it doesn't always seem to fit with an everyday logic all that well. But Macaulay hasn't finished yet, because he makes another point which I think is also really very important. Remember, his argument is that religion is fairly natural. Theology is not. It involves ways of thinking that cause us a bit of mental discomfort. And he then makes his second point, which is that in his view, that is also true of science. Now, what he's getting at is this. It's not that doing science is a problem. He's very, very supportive of science, thinks it's a wonderful thing. He's really talking about the realm of scientific theories, which again are very often deeply counterintuitive. And the point that Macaulay is making is that science, in effect, when it starts to develop its theories, ends up making very challenging demands of most people, which they find difficult to cope with. Here's the point he makes. Science challenges our intuitions and common sense repeatedly. With the triumph of new theories, scientists and sometimes even the public must readjust their thinking. And then he goes on. When first advanced the suggestions that the Earth moves, that solid objects are mostly empty space, were no less contrary to intuition and common sense than the most counterintuitive consequences of quantum mechanics have proved for us in the 20th century. What Macaulay is getting at in that point about solid objects is actually really quite important. I don't know how many of you have read Sir Arthur Eddington. This is going back quite a long way. But Arthur Eddington wrote a very famous book in the 1930s about the physical universe. And he asked his readers to imagine him sitting at a table. He said, actually, there are two tables. There's a common sense table, which is a solid object, and I'm leaning on it and writing this lecture. And he says, and then there's a different table. There's a table in which there are tiny points of matter, and then between them, there are vast spaces. So in effect, the table is mostly empty, apart from these immensely concentrated centers of mass. And the point he's trying to make is that the everyday world is like this, the scientific world is rather different, and actually it's very, very hard to get your head around the second, the more scientific approach. And the final point he makes is, as he writes his lecture on the table, he just adopts a common sense approach. There's something solid and real, I can lean on it and write my essay. But you see the point he's trying to make. A lot of these ideas actually demand intellectual concentration and cause a degree of intellectual discomfort. And certainly, I would agree with Macaulay when I was studying quantum theory back in the 1970s. It was very, very difficult for me to get a head around it because it seemed to be so counterintuitive. Something can be in two places at the same time. Something at one end of the universe can have a big impact on something at the other end of the universe. How on earth do you get your head around that? Macaulay is just making a very interesting observation, and then he draws a conclusion. Now, here's his conclusion. And I think he might be right, but see what you think. He's saying, suppose civilization collapsed and had to be rebuilt. His argument is that religion will be there, and eventually theology would emerge, and eventually science would emerge, but not immediately, because these require cultural support. They require, in effect, a community to be able to build up these ways of thinking. And they're not natural, even though they are legitimate. And for him, therefore, in effect, there's some very interesting questions to ask there. So what I've been talking about very briefly is this area called the cognitive science of religion. And it is simply putting before us this question for discussion: is religion natural? And C.S. Lewis may have overstated things a bit when he said that the human search for meaning is as natural as sexual desire or physical or thirst, but I think you can see what he's getting at and why these new cognitive approaches to the origins of religion seem to reflect this point. So one question we might then ask is, why are we hardwired in this way? I have to say to you that nobody really knows. And the danger is that we present rather speculative explanations as if they were obvious, well, like just-so stories, when in fact they're not really the case. I mean, to give you an example, you could offer a Darwinian explanation of why people find religion so natural, but to actually evaluate whether this is right and whether this is a good thing or a bad thing, you need to be able to answer the question as to whether religion is biologically adaptive or not. And I think many of you will know that there is really no agreement on this matter within the literature at the moment. Now, I could explore that question further, but we are working under time limits, and also I think the noise limits as well, which I apologise if it's impacting on this lecture. I don't think there's very much we can do about it. So what I want to do is pick up now on how someone who I think all of you know well and find interesting runs with this idea. I'm going to talk about C.S. Lewis. Now, the interesting point about C.S. Lewis is he's way before all this stuff about cognitive science of religion. And Lewis is simply saying, look, I'm reflecting on my own and others' experiences. I'm trying to ask the question, how do we make sense of these experiences? And Lewis in particular is very interested in the question of how do we make sense of a desire for God? Now, Lewis himself was an atheist to begin with and didn't really take this sort of stuff very seriously, but it became immensely important to him following his conversion around the 1930s. And Lewis talks about this theme in many of his writings. And you find it, for example, in a book of 1933. I may have put these up on the screen for you. This is Lewis's very first book, and some of you will know this, The Pilgrim's Regress. It's a very obvious development of the themes of John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. What Lewis is describing in this book is basically a journey. It's a journey to a mysterious island to which Lewis feels drawn. And when he finds his heart's desire, he then walks through the same country on his way home. That's the regress of the title. And the point that Lewis makes is, as he walks home through the same countryside, he sees it in a different way. In other words, Lewis is trying to develop the idea that in some way the encounter with your heart's desire is transformative, and it leads to seeing things in a new way. Some of you have read that book. It is actually quite a difficult book, but to be kind to him, it was his first, and he was developing his writing style. The second is a book, rather a sermon, that's only 5,000 words long. And many of you will probably have read this. This is Lewis's sermon, The Weight of Glory, preached in 1941. And it's a little vignette. It's one of the best things that Lewis wrote. And what he's trying to do in this again is to say, look, we have this experience of longing, of desire, which nothing in this world seems able to satisfy. So how do we interpret that experience? Is it simply meaningless, so we can leave it to one side? Is it pointing to something we haven't found yet, and therefore we might as well give up? Or is there something just beyond the horizon of experience which satisfies this deep sense of desire? And in this sermon, Lewis talks about God as, in effect, the fulfillment of human desire. And I'll talk a bit more about this in more detail later. The third place is a talk Lewis gave called Hope. And you may know Lewis shot to fame because of these talks he gave over the BBC during the Second World War. One of them was on the theme of hope, and that's now a chapter in his book Mere Christianity. And that is where Lewis tries to talk about the deeper significance of this sense of longing for something that nothing in this world seems able to satisfy. And then, of course, many of you will know Lewis's book, Surprised by Joy, in which this idea of joy plays a major role. What does Lewis mean by the word joy? Now, this book was written back in 53, so it's not about Lewis discovering the woman who he married in 1959, whenever it was, namely Joy Gresham. Lewis is using the word joy to mean something like this: an experience of intense longing, which seems enormously significant, but which seems to be unfathomable and unsatisfiable, if that's a word. He's trying to say, look, there's this exquisite sense of desire, almost painful, which as an experience is something enormously important, but it also raises the question, what does this experience mean? And for Lewis, one of the key themes in life is trying to find an intellectual framework that actually engages and makes sense of experience. And Lewis doesn't quote this line, but many of you will know it. It's from Eliot's Four Quartets, where Eliot gives us this little rather nice saying, we had the experience but missed the meaning. An approach to the meaning restores the experience. And that's very much Lewis's own experience. In effect, he had this experience of joy, but could not see what it was pointing to, if it was pointing to anything, and so was inclined to dismiss it as irrational or dystopian or just something that had no connection with the real world. And then Eliot's point is, once you approach the meaning, then it's not simply that the experience makes sense, but actually the experience becomes more real. And that certainly was Lewis's experience. And what Lewis is getting at is this, particularly in that chapter on hope, which you find in Mere Christianity. Lewis engages this experience of longing and asks, where does this take us? It's a very good question. Some of you will say, well, you know, it's a very interesting experience, but is it simply an experience that some people have and therefore might be very relevant to them, but not all? Is it culturally located? Is it just a limited number of people who have this kind of experience? And the evidence suggests that not everyone has this kind of experience, but a lot do. And so there'll be some of you listening to me lecture who will say, I'm not really quite sure what he's getting at, but I'm going to listen anyway. And there'll be some of you who will say, I know exactly what he's talking about. Let's see where he takes it. But let's just run with it and see where we go. The point is that actually there are many writers, some of them quite surprising, who talk about this kind of experience. Here's one of them. This is Bertrand Russell, writing a letter in 1917 as a relatively young man, describing to his lover one of the things that's right at the heart of his life, which he can't shake off, he can't make sense of it, but it's there. I'll read it to you because it's a very well-written little passage. The centre of me is always and eternally a terrible pain, a searching for something beyond which the world contains, something transfigured and infinite, the beatific vision, God. I don't find it. I don't think it is to be found. But the love of it is my life. It's the actual spring of life within me. Obviously, this is in the middle of a very intimate letter, and perhaps Russell self-disclosed more than was wise. We don't really find this in his published writings of the period. But nevertheless, you can see what he's getting at. He's saying, there is something at the heart of my existential life, which is really, really important. I just don't know what to do with it, but it's the spring of life within me. And that's really what Lewis is engaging, that kind of experience. He's saying, it might mean nothing, it might mean something very, very important. Let's try and generate a framework which helps us to make sense of that. And so Lewis is basically saying we need to formulate a framework that helps us to make sense of this desire. And in the case of Bertrand Russell, Russell just said, look, I can't really make sense of this. His daughter, Catherine Tate, let me see if I've got this here for you, basically wrote these words, which I think are very interesting. She wrote, somewhere at the back of my father's mind, at the bottom of his heart, in the depths of his soul, was an empty space that had once been filled by God, and he never found anything else to put in it. And she remarked that Russell, her father, was now haunted, I quote, by a ghost-like feeling of not belonging in this world. So, what is his experience? Well, obviously, Russell had that experience he tried to put into words, but clearly, it was really important to him. And what Lewis does in this chapter in Hope is to try and open up what this experience might be. And what Lewis says is that we need to bring some sort of intellectual framework to bear on this experience and see whether it makes sense of it. And if it does make sense of it, what does it say this experience is all about? So what Lewis does in this chapter in Mere Christianity, the lecture Hope, is to say, let me bring a theological framework on this experience and see where it takes us. And as I said in an earlier lecture, what Lewis does is in effect to argue that Christianity provides us with this big picture, this intellectual framework, this lens, if you like, which brings things into focus and helps us to make sense of them. And Lewis was always very cautious about using this kind of approach. You cannot argue from experience to validation of a philosophy or theology. He was very, very clear, you cannot prove any theology or philosophy from nature. He writes, nature will not verify any theological, metaphysical presupposition, or proposition, sorry. But look at the last part of that. She will, however, help to show what it means. And that really is what Lewis is trying to get at. Lewis is saying, look, it's not as if somehow our experience proves that there is a God, something like that. It's rather, it provides a way of making sense of this experience. And those of you who enjoy reading G.K. Chesterton will know he says something very similar. In The Everlasting Man, he says, I quote, "The phenomenon does not prove religion, but religion explains the phenomenon." I'll read that again. "The phenomenon does not prove religion." In other words, you see this, it doesn't prove there's God, but religion explains the phenomenon. In other words, here's a framework which, when brought to bear on what you observe, seems to offer a way of explaining what its meaning is. So the framework that Lewis brings to bear is this. He argues that Christianity holds that the natural order, including us, is shaped by the God who created all things. And Lewis argues that the absence of God causes us to experience longing. In other words, if we are meant to relate to God and we don't relate to God, there is an absence where there is meant to be a presence, a sense of longing or dissatisfaction or emptiness. And Lewis, like Augustine before him, says we might interpret, which for Lewis would be a misinterpretation, we might interpret this as simply longing for something within the world. Whereas for Lewis, these desires actually are like the breeze blowing from a distant country, which in effect wafts the scent of a distant flower. It's something beyond our horizons, which nevertheless impacts on where we are and makes us wonder if there is more to life than what we experience and see around us. So Lewis's argument, more formally, goes something like this. He argues that we experience desires that no experience in this world is able to satisfy. So that's his observation. He doesn't say it applies to everyone, it certainly applied to himself. And there are lots of other people who keep popping up who will say, I know exactly what he means. Then Lewis says, right, let us now bring in a framework and see how well the framework maps onto the experience. Christianity tells us, he says, that we are made for another world. And when things are seen in this way, this sort of experience is exactly what we'd expect. In other words, Lewis is saying this is not about a proof. It's rather saying here are the observations. Here is a theoretical map. The question is, how well do the observations fit onto the theoretical map? And again, there are some parallels there with the approach we sometimes called inference to the best explanation in the natural sciences, where what you are doing is saying that there are the observations, we can line them all up. Here are a number of possible theoretical frameworks. Let's impose each of these frameworks and see how well they cope with what is actually observed. So Lewis's argument from desire, which is what I've been talking about, isn't really an argument in the sense of this, therefore this, therefore this. It's much more an imaginative experiment. Here is what we experience. Imagine that this framework is right. How well does it make sense of your experience? And Lewis's argument is that actually this way of thinking does quite a lot of justice to it. A similar line of approach is found in his argument from morality. Lewis doesn't say we have this sense of moral obligation, therefore there's God. It's much more we do have the sense of moral obligation deep within us, which actually doesn't prove anything. But if there were a God, then maybe that framework helps us to make sense of this experience. So the basic point I've been making about Lewis's approach is that it is very, very good at engaging experience. Lewis is not an abstract thinker. He, in effect, begins with our experience of the world, which he describes, and asks, how on earth can we make sense of this? And one of them is this experience of what he calls joy, this exquisite, tantalizing, deep sense of longing for something which makes us wonder if we will ever find that desire satisfied. And Lewis then begins to say, now I've described the experience, let's try and unpack what the meaning will be. And that's again coming back to the end of that quote, nature will help us to show what it means. So Lewis is affirming the rationality of the universe, and again he's bringing us back to that quotation from Eliot. We had the experience, but missed the meaning. An approach to the meaning restores the experience. Now, there's a lot more I could say about Lewis, but the main point I'm making today simply is this, that if this cognitive science of religion is right, then we have these experiences which are very, very natural to us, and we intuitively get the sense these point beyond us towards God. And Lewis gives us one way of beginning to make that connection. The issue is having these experiences, these intuitions, and then how do we solidify these? How do we get from there to, in effect, connection with, for example, Christianity? And Lewis is an example of someone who builds a bridge by which that might happen. Now, if I had more time, I'd talk about that more, but I don't. And I want to raise another question, which I think is controversial. And I'm going to tell you what I think about this one. But again, it's one of those things where I'm going to throw you some ideas and just see what you think. Let's imagine that it is natural to be religious. I think there's a lot of reason to think that might be right. I know some of you will want to discuss that, but how might we respond to the idea that religion is a very natural phenomenon for human beings when the word humanism is used in modern language to mean an anti-religious attitude or outlook? So the question I'm going to ask is whether actually that word humanism needs a little bit of recalibration or redirection. And so what I thought I'd do is just play around with this for a few moments and see what you think. I mean, some of you don't know this, but back in the 1980s, my research interests were really in early 16th century thought in Switzerland. And I would spend a lot of time in libraries in Zurich and Vienna looking at the writings of early Swiss humanists like Vadianus and Glarianus and Xylotectus, who were very, very interesting writers standing at the cusp between the Renaissance and the modern period. And what was interesting about all those writers is that although the Renaissance really didn't have its own distinctive philosophy, none of these humanists were in the least bit anti-religious. They actually saw religion as fulfilling something very, very deep within human nature, which they thought was a good thing. If you read someone like Erasmus, you will find two things side by side, which I think many of you will find puzzling, but they're both there. One of them is this affirmation, religion is really important for human beings. And then, on the next line virtually, but the church is so awful. You know, and in effect, some people then read from the church is so awful to therefore religion is bad. Actually, the point that Erasmus is making is that the institutional embodiment of religion fails to do justice to what is. And particularly in his book, The Handbook of the Christian Soldier, 1503, Erasmus really says we need a reformation so the church becomes much more like what religion is really meant to be. And the word humanism just doesn't mean secularism or atheism back at the time of the Renaissance. So one of the questions we might ask is how does it come to have these overtones today? And I think there are simple historical reasons for this. I think that as I read things, what's happened is that there have always been various schools of humanism. There has always been a Jewish humanism. There's always been a Christian humanism. Erasmus of Rotterdam is a very, very good example. So is Thomas More. So is Thomas Collett. And there have also been secular forms of humanism, which have said something like this: to achieve true human identity and destiny, we need to, in effect, deny the transcendent or get rid of any idea of God. But interestingly, all of these are really humanisms. All of them are talking about what is required for human beings to be fulfilled, to, in effect, undergird core human values like dignity and truth and beauty and goodness. And you can give religious answers, you can give secular answers. And what I want to suggest to you is actually maybe the word humanism really has become elided or equated with secular humanism. And the point I just want to raise for discussion with you is whether we need to recapture, if you like, a bigger picture of humanism. I mean, I personally disagree with secular humanism, but I've no doubt at all it is a form of humanism. I'm just saying we need a bigger tent, a bigger vision of what humanism is. I think that could be a very interesting thing to do. Some people would say that, for example, the idea of Christian humanism is an oxymoron, if you're an American, a contradiction in terms, if you're British. But I don't think it is. I think that the word humanism actually has this much richer sense of meaning about what it means to be truly human and how we achieve the identity and the destiny we believe to be ours. But of course, there are different understandings of what it means to be human, what our true fulfillment is, and so on. And maybe we just need to open this up in a broader way. And a good example of someone who reflects on these themes is Mary Midgley. Mary Midgley, as you all know, is now in her 90s, still a very able writer, a formidable person, as I've discovered in personal debates. But interestingly, I would describe her, and I hope I'm not in any way doing her an injustice, I would describe her as a non-theistic humanist. She doesn't believe in God. But nevertheless, she's very, very clear that humanism has to be careful. She makes the interesting point that an aggressively anti-theistic humanism can pull the rug out from under itself. Now, there's an essay by Mary Midgley that you may find interesting. It's called The Paradox of Humanism, okay? Mary Midgley, The Paradox of Humanism. And her argument goes like this. All reductive forms of humanism eliminate the transcendent in the mistaken belief that this safeguards the human. But she argues, humanism exists, I quote, to celebrate and increase the glory of human life. And she makes the point that, you know, in her view, you don't need to believe in God to be able to do that. But here's a point. As soon as anyone starts to eliminate things like God or the transcendent, I quote again, valuable elements in human life begin to unravel. Why? Here's her answer. Again, I'm quoting. Because the patterns essential to human life turn out to be ones that cannot be altogether contained within it. I'll read that again. The patterns essential to human life turn out to be ones that cannot altogether be contained within it. And she concludes like this. To be fully human seems to be involved in being interested in other things as well as human ones, and sometimes more than human ones. Now, there's some food for thought. It's just a very interesting question, and one I think that is still wide open for discussion. Now, I have to end this lecture without resolving those issues, but I think I ought to end these lectures by talking about what we're doing next year. In other words, just by giving you a little taster of the lectures we're going to be giving next year. What I'm going to be doing is talking about that broad theme, religion, science, and culture, six big questions. What I'm going to do with is, in effect, reflect on what I think are six really interesting questions. And to make it more interesting, I'm going to always use a dialogue partner. In other words, there'll always be somebody else who I'll keep referring to, who I'll keep quoting from, to make sure there's an alternative perspective. So in effect, you know, it's not just me saying, here's what I think, it'll always be somebody else as well saying what they think, so that you've got a very interesting dialogue. Now obviously, this doesn't mean there'll be somebody else present, but there will be another voice in the lectures in that I'll be quoting from somebody else to make points and explore them. Sometimes I'll agree with this person, sometimes I'll disagree with them, but I think you'll agree it'll make it much more interesting. So here's the first one. I'm going to look at that topic. Does science rob nature of its mystery and beauty? And might theology restore it? It's a really interesting question. Here is the person I've chosen as my dialogue partner for this. I hope you'll feel this is good. I thought we'd look at John Ruskin. Ruskin is a major cultural figure of the 19th century, very, very concerned about this. You may remember he was very concerned about the Lake District being polluted from Manchester's factories. But on the other hand, thought science was great. It was just, how do you get the balance right? And so I think this might be a very interesting lecture. Second lecture is this: does faith make sense of things? I've touched on a lot in these lectures, but never really focused on specifically. And again, it's a very interesting question. And the dialogue partner I've chosen is Dorothy Sayers. Why? Well, she writes beautifully, I think. This was, for her, a very major theme. There's some very interesting letters in which she talks about this being, you know, the thing that lay at the heart of her life back in the 1940s. And, of course, the Lord Peter Wimsey novels are all about trying to make sense of things. So, actually, this could be a very nice way of opening up some of these questions with a very engaging voice, who I think will move us on some very interesting directions. Then, thirdly, is reality limited to what science can uncover? Again, it's a contentious question, one I think is very, very interesting. And you probably won't be surprised to know that I'll be engaging with C.S. Lewis, for whom this is a very big question, particularly Lewis's book, The Abolition of Man, 1943. Very concerned about this, that we simply offer a scientifically reduced vision of human nature, which doesn't actually give us space for our emotions, for love, a whole series of things like that. This, I think, will be very, very interesting. Then, a fascinating question, respecting and transcending nature. How do we keep nature beautiful, but at the same time use it in helpful and appropriate ways? And it's a very important cultural question, it's a very important religious question. The person I'm going to engage in dialogue with is J.R.R. Tolkien. Some of you may say, why? If you think of The Lord of the Rings, either the original novels or the movie versions, you'll notice that for Tolkien, technology is always about destruction and the forging of weapons of war. And so one of the things I'm going to do is just ask, why is Tolkien so worried about this? Is there something valid there? And if so, where might it take us? And again, it's a really interesting topic. Then in the fifth lecture, is humanity naturally good? It's a very interesting question. I would love to be able to say yes, unqualified, but I just can't, because it's so obviously much more complicated than that. Who would you choose to open that one up? I thought initially Alexander Pope, his essay on man. But I thought, no, there's somebody much more interesting who would do this very well for us. I thought we'd look at Richard Dawkins' book, The Selfish Gene, in which Dawkins, you know, in effect, opens up this question: if there's something about us that biologically predisposes us to be selfish, and if there is, what can we do about it? And obviously, he and I would disagree on many things, but A, this is a very important question, and B, he says some very interesting things. So I think he'll be a very welcome voice in that conversation. And then finally, is matter evil? Those of you who know your history will be aware this is right at the heart of the Gnostic controversies, you know, which basically saw humanity as a stranger in an evil, contaminating universe. We need to get out of this place as quickly as possible. That sort of line of thinking has always been there in Western culture. And I think you'll probably guess who I'm going to engage with, and I hope you'll feel this is an appropriate choice. I thought if we looked at Philip Pullman's Dark Materials trilogy, that would give us a very good conversation partner to open this up. So, ladies and gentlemen, that is next year. That's just a very brief map of the kind of things we'll be looking at. We are moving venue, so actually we can get more people in, and I hope you'll find that much more satisfactory. I know all of us would like to thank you for being so patient about the limitations under which you've had to give these lectures. But it just remains for me to thank you so much for coming throughout this lecture series. And I very much hope I'll be seeing you again when these lecture series begin in the autumn. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening.